Delivering the multiverse since 2009. This is Sci-Fi for Me TV. Thanks for watching Sci-Fi for Me TV. Be sure to connect with us on social media and subscribe to our channels so you don't miss our next broadcast. You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV, delivering the multiverse since 2009.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, children of all ages, Mr. and Mrs. America, all the ships at sea, conversationalists across fruited plain, princes of the universe, captains courageous, the ladies who launch people on the wrong side of the tracks, this is Open Line Friday. And it is your turn. You get to steer the ship today, and we've got some different things to talk about. However, at some point during the program, hopefully early, Paul Dergarabedian from Comscore will be here to talk about CinemaCon news. So that's coming. So as soon as he jumps in, we will cut to that. In the meantime, we will put the links up in the chat for those of you who want to take over the show today. I'll do that here in just a second. If you are with us live, you can participate in the conversation. Sound is really low, is it? Why is that? It shouldn't be. Hold on. Let me look. Stupid machines. Here we go again. Let's try that. Is that better? God bless America. Here we go again. I really hate Windows. I hate Microsoft. I hate Windows. Everything's off. Why is this doing this? Stop it. Everything. I don't know. I don't know what's doing it. Is it going to stay? Is it going to stay? Let's see if it stays. It looks like it's going to stay. Maybe. I don't know. It's almost like I have to disable it and then re-enable it for some reason. I don't know exactly what's going on here. This is just absolutely ridiculously stupid. But it looks like it's holding steady now. Welcome, everybody. Linux for the win. Yeah. All right. So, yes, we are broadcasting live to YouTube, Odyssey, Rumble. So you can jump in the chat, participate in the conversation. You can also participate in the conversation such as it is over on Discord. Email address, livefromthebunker@scififorme.com. We've got a newsletter. We've got social media. We have Subscribestar, all that good stuff. Excuse me. It's not a bug. It's a feature. It's not a tumor. All right, let's say hi to everybody in the chat. Weatherman's here. Cam's here. Taylor Swift, greater than Disney, Star Wars, and MCU. You might get some debate on that. Green Girl is here. Matt Tween's here. Sci-Fi Snob's here. Death Angel Shadow's here. RV Life is here over on Odyssey. By the way, Sci-Fi Snob and I think Cam are going to fill in next week because we don't have shows. Next week, we're dark here because I have to work the day job, babysitting equipment during a conference. I've just got to kind of sit and make sure that nothing catches fire, I guess. So that's going on all week. So, over on Sci-Fi Snob's channel, they will be doing Dead from the Dugout for a week, I guess, maybe. So... something to look forward to over there. And coming close, it's on its way. It is very, very close here. We're inching towards number 700. And with us not having a show on Wednesday, it's thrown off the episode count, of course, because this would have been 690 instead of 689. And that throws things off. So next week, everything's off. The week after that, we'd go 690 through 694. And the week after that, 695 through 699, which would put 699 on a Friday. Which, if we want to catch up, because, you know, completist OCD me, we could do 700... on May the 4th, which I've sent an invitation to somebody and said, you know, our 700th episode is going to be on May the 4th, and might not be a bad way to go on that. So I'm waiting to hear back. I don't know. We'll see. Anyway, so there is that. All right, so let me do this. Let me put the link in the chat. Where's the chat? Here. There's that. Put it there. Put it there. And pin it. Pin the message. Pin the message. In those places where I can pin the message. And while we're waiting for everybody else to join us, we will start with Mr. Christopher Hoffman, who is here to share something with us. I don't know. What have you got, Christopher? Good afternoon. Hi. How are you?
Hey, good afternoon. How are you?
That's something going on with your microphone there. So what's up?
Not so. I wanted to touch on two things real quick. One, the Tosca's sisters or the Twisted Twins responsible for the updated Rabid movie and also American Mary and are now part of the Lookoverse. With their Yara comic, their homage to George A. Romero and his zombie universe, Festival of the Living Dead is currently streaming on Tubi. It's a pretty good flick. It's tempered by the lack of budget, but luckily the sisters have enough imagination and have cast some really charismatic actors in the roles that have made up for the budgetary limitations. Had they had a little more money, I think they would have been able to touch a little bit more on some of the issues brought up in the script. Sort of like, you know, Romero did this like consumerism commentary for Dawn of the Dead and that that sort of thing. But that being said, it's a fun little zombie flick, and it's free if you're willing to put up with intermittent commercials.
Yeah.
Festival of the Dead, and it's on TV right now.
Speaking of intermittent, your audio is cutting in and out. I think you've got your you might want to check your Windows settings. I think your audio ducking is on. It's clipping you, and every now and again, you just kind of just go really muffled.
Okay, check that.
Every now and again, you're very clear, and it's just it's one of these random back and forths that's happening on that microphone. I don't know what I would check the audio ducking and the echo cancellation maybe.
And that so well yeah actually I've got disabled Windows audio ducking check, so
that's weird. I wonder what's causing that.
And that, but that was on OBS. I guess I will check the. I'll see if I can check the other system.
It may be in OBS. I don't know.
But
it's
yeah. We've got the Festival of the Dead is a fun movie. Not as substantial as I thought it would be, but that being said, like I mentioned, it's a. Limited by its low budget, certainly not necessarily by its execution or the performances.
Yeah.
There is also a fun story that I found a couple of days ago that has sort of gone under the radar a little bit. It's about a great little indie video game. That I think even you would enjoy, Jason.
Okay.
It's a combination of a cozy gameplay with some Lovecraftian horror. And it's a fishing game called Dredge. And what you do is you're playing a fisherman who is stationed at this like kind of sort of out-of-the-way archipelago. Excuse me, I butchered that word. Series of islands, and the fisherman travels around the different islands, and he upgrades his boat and stuff like that. Mm. He also dredges the water to not only fish, but also find like various treasures and keys to the mysteries upon that are linked to the various islands around the country. Well, it turns out that this video game, which sold over 100,000 copies within its first month of release in March of 2023, and has gone on to sell a million copies as of right now. They're getting a live-action movie. And,
oh, is that what that was? I saw a headline about that the other day, and I was wondering what that was. Okay, so I did see the news that there was getting an adaptation. So,
yeah, and the video game itself is $30 to $35, so it's like extremely affordable.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just a really fun game with a very interesting, intriguing storyline. They do have some downloadable content, some extra stuff that you can get. There's a new one coming out in the next couple of months,
okay.
A new chapter of it, but you don't necessarily need those, they're just extras. You can play the game with the experience yourself, and it's really fun. It's got a really interesting art style. I've got a copy of the book here along with the video game. It shows like kind of the art style of the game, as you can see right there.
Oh, okay.
Some of the fish and some of the mutated fish that you find, and here we go, some more of the anglerfish.
Okay, and this is called Dredge.
Yeah, it's called okay. Dredge. And we've got, here's some of the art style of like the island and stuff like that. So it's got that kind of cozy sort of Stardew Valley Animal Crossing sort of feel to it. You are limited to kind of like staying on the boat and everything like that. You do get to go on land, but you don't have like a 3D avatar.
Okay, well, that looks interesting. Okay, well,
great watercolor.
Okay, well, I'm going to cut you off there for a second because Paul Dergarabedian is in the back in waiting for us, and he's got a limited time. So I'm going to put you in the back, and you can check your audio stuff. I think maybe if you had headphones on, it might cut out some of that stuff. I don't know for sure, though. So I'm going to put you in the green room, and we're going to bring in Paul Dergarabedian, Senior Media Analyst from Comscore. Welcome, sir. How you doing?
Great to be here, Jason.
So I've got this headline here from Deadline, and it made me think of you because I think you're in this. 2024 global box office projection revised upwards by analysts on eve of CinemaCon. So this is before CinemaCon happened in Las Vegas this week. And I guess we're expecting the box office to be better than it was originally estimated. Is that what I'm reading here?
Yeah, I think that's the takeaway there. It's very interesting, though. There's such a fixation on box office, and of course there always is. But for me to say, what are we, mid-April, to be changing the projections is kind of interesting. And I think everyone agrees that to achieve $9 billion next year, or excuse me, to exceed $9 billion this year is not going to happen.
Yeah.
Last year had Barbenheimer, Sound of Freedom, Five Nights at Freddy's, a bunch of huge films. We had a $4 billion summer. We got to $9.05 billion domestically. I think the estimate now is for $8.2 billion for this year. That sounds pretty much in line. And after being at CinemaCon, I'd have to agree that it is going to be a great year for moviegoers, if not a $9 billion year, and certainly not an $11 billion year, which is what we had in the past.
Well, and we've gotten news about all of these different sequels and requels and reboots and that kind of thing, because we have... Beetlejuice.
Yes.
We have another Five Nights at Freddy's being announced. We have a Scary Movie franchise getting rebooted and coming back.
Yep. Everything's a franchise,
old is new
again. Reboot, a prequel. Furiosa, though, looked really cool.
Yeah.
They showed a lot of footage from that.
So how did you get a chance? Did you see the Beetlejuice footage?
Yes. And I got to actually stand about 10 feet away from Tim Burton. And I have to say his hair is amazing.
Nice. Yeah.
And I have no problem with that. If you bring back the original filmmaker, I'm kind of cool with these reboots, but I don't like it when it's like executive produced by somebody who had something to do with this movie 30 years ago.
Yeah.
And, I have to say, like, the Robert Eggers Nosferatu, they showed some extended footage. That just looks amazing. Robert Eggers, of course, did The Lighthouse and a very stylized filmmaker. There was at the Warner Brothers presentation, there was a lot of footage of a Christopher Reeve documentary called Superman.
Yes.
And that was, I mean, there wasn't a dry eye in the house at the trailer, man. It was like pretty, I had no idea about his friendship with Robin Williams. He and Robin Williams
were very tight. They were roommates at Juilliard, I think, is where they met.
Yeah, I didn't know that. I don't know how I missed that, but that's pretty cool.
Well, and it's getting a theatrical release in September, picked up by Warner Brothers, appropriately enough.
Yes.
And Peter Safran is the one who confirmed that. We don't have a date, but we do have a month. So this is basically a documentary directed by Ian Bonholt and mm-hmm. Peter Edigui. I'm probably messing that up. But it's basically home movies and archives about his time you know, becoming Superman, and then after the accident and stuff and his life. I'm looking forward to seeing it. I've heard a lot of really good stuff about it.
Yeah, so, and I love documentaries, man, and especially in a movie theater. I mean, we're so accustomed to seeing them on the small screen, but to see something like this on the big screen is really inspiring, actually, this film, just from the trailer. Some other highlights, Warner Brothers were the Watchers. That they showed footage from that, Mickey 17. So they showed a lot of footage. They had some filmmakers out on stage, actors. Just a great week in Vegas, although I'm glad to be home, Jason. Those weeks really kick your butt, I have to say.
I'm sure. Now, let me ask you this, because CinemaCon is not like a Comic-Con. It's more an industrial thing. You know, this is the, you know, industry people and distributors and whatnot. But is there the risk of con crud like you would find after a Comic-Con? Because, you know, a lot of times people go to the Comic-Con, so they come home, they get sick because there's so many people around.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I'm fine.
Okay.
but I came home from CinemaCon 2 years ago and I had COVID. I was like, oh no, did this really happen?
Yeah.
But no, I don't have con crud yet. I do have con. I overate and, I had a good time. Let's just put it that way. Because a big part of this is not just going to the proscribed event, you know, the events that you're supposed to go to, but the interaction you have with people in your industry, many of whom you may not see in everyday life or other than on a Zoom call. So to be one-on-one with all these folks in the industry is really cool.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, yeah. And there's a lot of fandoms that are starting to do these get-togethers in and around events. I know last year there was a meetup around Dallas, Fan Days, Fan Expo Dallas. This year they were in Vegas the same year, same time CinemaCon was going on. They've been, you know, there've been meetups all over the United States, various different people who don't have any real connection to anyone other than we're all connected through the YouTube stuff, and they're all meeting up together for the first time in person. Oh, you're taller than I thought you were. You know, that kind of thing.
Nothing like having that one-on-one with people.
Yeah, but there's a different dynamic too, I would think. Absolutely. Because you meet somebody in person, it's a completely different kind of interaction that you get when you got microphones and headphones.
Wait a sec. We've never met in person.
I know, we need to.
I don't know what that would be like. I think it'd be epic. We have to make that happen.
We do. And I think you're taller than I am, probably.
I don't. Who knows? We're all the same height sitting down, you know?
That's right. That's right. Well, I mean, it's one of those things where, you know, you develop these connections, and it's not really surreal, but especially post-pandemic, this almost seems to be the default anymore, where before you were actually going out to Comic Cons and actually meeting and interacting with people a whole lot more than we do now.
Yeah.
So I don't know. It's just kind of a strange.
It is. I have a journalist friend who I've been talking to on the phone and on Zoom for the last almost 10 years. And we came out to LA a couple of weeks ago and we got to hang out. We were like, I don't know, peas and carrots. We totally hit it off. So that was great.
Yeah.
And then real quick, I know we really want to talk about CinemaCon, but I also want to talk about a little bit about Civil War.
Yes, that's opening this weekend. Today. Yeah.
And then we have the upcoming summer, you know, in a couple of weeks, we'll be starting the summer movie season, which will be very, and we could do another segment on that once we get into the summer. But kicking off with The Fall Guy, not a Marvel movie this year, as was tradition, especially in the pre-pandemic era.
Yeah.
And then, I mean, there's no Barbenheimer on the horizon. I mean, Furiosa and Planet of the Apes were originally opening on Memorial Weekend together, which would have been pretty amazing.
That would have been kind of an event level marketing opportunity there, I think.
Yeah, but they blinked and they, well, those movies are much more like, let's say, than Barbie and Oppenheimer.
That's true.
So that may have been why. And The Fall Guy, they screened it there. I didn't see it on Monday at CinemaCon. I think that's a good movie to just kick off the summer. That feels like a summer movie to me. But to me, the movies coming out from like Focus Features, like The Bike Riders and Nosferatu, these other, the indie films that come out during the summer are often the best ones, in my opinion. Often they wait for the holiday or the awards season to put those out. But the ones that come out in the summer can often be really, really great films.
Well, let me ask you this, because I've seen an article talking about how the theaters, the theater people at CinemaCon are basically saying, we need more movies, we need more programming, we need more stuff. Yeah. Do you have any indication that the studios are leaning back toward more, smaller, better, instead of, well, you know, because we've talked about this before, the $250 million blockbuster movie, you can only do one or two of those a year. You can't do 10. So
exactly. Well, I think Universal has a great setup in the sense of they have their focus features to provide the indie-style films, lower and mid-budget films, and then they have their blockbusters that come out through Universal.
Yeah.
But I, you know, this year, I think we're going to, on the schedule right now is 105 wide release films. That's much better than 2 years ago when there were 71.
Oh, yes.
And that 71 was 41 fewer than in the pre-pandemic era. That's a 41 fewer wide releases is a lot fewer, but we're getting back that 100 plus. By wide release, I mean films that open in over 2,000 locations or have ultimately play in over 2,000 theaters as well.
Yeah.
So it is about product. It's about the number, but you know, quality over quantity, man. It's just like, if you just put a bunch of movies out there and they don't perform, that's a budgetary issue. If you're just throwing money at that, but then it's also about figuring out which movies should go in a theater and which ones go straight to streaming, like Roadhouse went straight to Prime. I know Doug Liman was not happy about that, but they have to pick their battles, I guess. So we'll see how Civil War does this weekend. What's going on in the movie world, of course.
So, okay, the assumption with Civil War is that it's some kind of political message and people are going to come away from it. You know, it's very divisive and, you know, Trump bashing and all of that. But I'm seeing reviews that basically say this one is relatively tame and mild, and they really kind of don't really, they stay safe. They don't really do anything edgy or daring or even really, you know, worth the time. It's kind of a bland show.
I've heard that too, and it's apolitical in a sense. And I think a lot of people were hoping for this very incendiary movie. And I love Alex Garland. Well, I loved Ex Machina. I thought it was a great film. But yeah, I think that what we may see happening is that people start pontificating about this film without having seen it and saying it may have one particular point of view or another. But
yeah,
I heard the same thing from a friend of mine that it's not like the movie. I mean, the trailer is probably more divisive than in the movie.
I'm still trying to wrap my head around the idea of Texas and California doing anything together, much less rebelling against the United States government. I mean, I can see Texas doing it, California not so much. I just, you know,
well, you make a good point there, but Jason, that it was quite the week. I'm very tired. Only for you am I doing this.
Well,
tell you, Vegas, when I was younger, because I used to. The first CinemaCon I went to was in 1995, and it was at the Bally's Hotel. Then it shifted to Paris. It was called Show West then.
Yep.
And a few years ago, they changed it to CinemaCon, but it's still a big deal, man. A ton of people there, great events.
What was
and
the
just getting to meet with all your friends in the industry?
Yeah. What was the biggest surprise for you coming out of there as far as news and things that got announced?
Well, I mean, look, Wicked is a movie that I wasn't sure about, but after the presentation, like, wow, this could be a really big movie at the end of the year, Thanksgiving. I didn't know about the Christopher Reeve documentary at all.
Yeah.
That wasn't that's not like a huge announcement, but I just think that there's general positivity in the industry while trying to reconcile that with that we're going to be at, like, as that article showed at the top of this, like 8.2 billion instead of over 9 billion like last year, the year. But I think there's plenty of movies in the pipeline, a lot of cool stuff on the way, a lot of prequels and sequels. But Jason, I've always said, if the movie's good, I don't care if it's a prequel or a sequel or an origin story or whatever. And I'm anxious for Joker, Deadpool. There's some good movies there, but Nosferatu, that's the one I'm... Oh, and Conclave.
Conclave. That one I haven't heard of.
Yeah, that's Ralph Fiennes. It's about the Catholic Church in Italy and how they choose a pope. And I don't know. I'm not well-versed in those areas, but the movie looks really good.
Interesting. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I haven't heard of that one. I'll have to look into that one. Now, I know you don't have a whole lot of time, but let me ask you this one thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
With a lot of people saying that streaming is finally going to start looking at profitability between now and 2025, what are the chances that some stuff that could go to theaters ends up streaming because, hey, we're going to start making money now? Do you think that's going to be a factor in 2024 yet?
It could be. I think the issue is going to be with filmmakers. I mean, they're going to want to have, I think baked into the cake of future deals may be, I want a theatrical release first, and maybe some of the filmmakers have it. But if you don't get a theatrical and you don't get a streaming release, nobody's going to see your movie.
Yeah.
So, but I think as they do that, they may try and put more movies that might have gone to theaters on streaming. But as we all know, if you put them in a theater first and then they wind up on streaming, you get a bit of a boost in the prestige and want to see factor. But it's the Wild West. It's interesting how the theater side is kind of stabilized a bit compared to where it was 2 or 3 years ago. And streaming is kind of the Wild West. I mean, the biggest competitor for streaming or for broadcast is streaming, and not the big screen. It's small screen fighting small screen content for other competitors in the space. So we're living in an interesting time, let's say that.
Well, see, and I've always thought that if you treated streaming like cable, where you have you have your theatrical run, whether it's a 45-day run or 3 months or however long, and then you wait, like, say, a month, and then it comes back on cable. In this case, it comes back on streaming. And then you could do your traditional windows like you used to do. You have your theatrical run, you have your cable run, you have your broadcast network run, and then home video. We miss out on so much in terms of word of mouth and momentum nowadays because it's either theatrical or streaming, and it's done and it's gone.
You know, I love that you said that, Jason. That's a great point, because sometimes the old ways are better, and that traditional model now. A 90-day window probably wouldn't work today, theatrical.
Yeah.
But that old school, the reason it was around for so long is because it worked. Now, we live in a different world than we did when it was sell-through video and there was no streaming and that kind of thing. Yeah. So it's definitely changed. But I don't know, we're going to find new modes of business. And another part of this, too, is just the event cinema, international cinema, all the things that we talked about last year that did well. Theaters need content, that's for sure. They need movies too. I mean, I go to the theater to see a movie, not a piece of content.
The thing, that's the thing. All right, well, Paul, what's up next for you? You're gonna recover? You got any other events that you're doing? Or
I'm doing a live news tonight about Civil War. I've got a lot of stuff coming up in the coming weeks. I'm gonna relaunch my podcast. We've been talking about this forever. And I have a podcast called Ticket to Ride with my buddy Mike Polidoris from Paper Airplane. And so Comscore, they support that effort totally. And so looking to do more of that. You owe me, man. You got to be a guest.
I'm ready to go. Just let me know.
All right. I'm going to hit you up for that.
All right, Paul.
My apologies to your previous guest for jumping in. No,
it's okay. It's okay. He'll be back. He's in the back just waiting. We're all set. All right,
man. Well, thank you, Jason. Okay. Have a great weekend.
You too. And Paul's links are in the notes for you to follow him over on Twitter and the podcast. Paul Dergarabedian from Comscore. Thanks very much for being here, sir. Have a great weekend.
Great to be here. You too.
All right. We will talk to you soon. And Anybody else that wants to jump in here, you are more than welcome to do that. Let me go. Let's see if Christopher has got his audio back upstage. We're going to pull Christopher back in. Hello, sir.
Hello again.
Oh, that's better. That's better. What'd you do different?
I just checked some stuff off and updated my personal software.
It's still doing it a little bit, but not as bad. It might be on my end. I don't know. Let me look here. Let me check my settings. Sure. Let me check my settings.
I just remember last week we were having a similar problem as well. So.
That's doing that. I'm at 100 there. All right. I don't know. I honestly just don't know. This is why we've got to go back to using Zoom. I've never been a big fan of StreamYard, you know? Just haven't. So,
yeah, it certainly seems lately that it's either there's been like a OS system for StreamYards or something like that, but it's definitely affecting you having like guests and stuff like
I don't
that.
Know if it's a I don't know if it's a StreamYard update that maybe went sideways or what. I don't know. It's very strange, but sorry, what? Yeah, it's Christopher. You're jumping on. You have to say apparently, Miss. What? You have to say something. All right, Mrs. Boss has something to say to Christopher.
Okay.
I don't know what we're gonna do. This. I guess it could be okay.
Okay, this looks really bad because I'm not going to sit there and go through the 9 yards of twisting that because of my arm.
Okay.
But Christopher, you'll appreciate this one. And I meant to send you something. So Monday we had the eclipse, right? And all of my groups online were just kind of like, don't forget today's rule. Don't buy any plants. I did. And her name is Audrey, too. So.
What?
There we go.
Did you really?
You've never seen the movie. You have no clue.
No, I haven't seen the movie.
He's never seen this movie.
I haven't seen it. I haven't seen it.
I may have to go get it so you can see it.
Okay. You have two opportunities to see the movie. Okay. There's one with the musical. Okay. That's fantastic, directed by Frank Oz. I recommend seeing both endings, though. One of them is the theatrical happy ending. The other one was the ending that Frank Oz wanted to put into theaters, but everybody said it was a downer. But it's much more appropriate. But if you don't want to go the musical route, if that's too namby-pamby for you, things like that, you can also go to the original Roger Corman movie that has Jack Nicholson in it in a small part called Little Shop of Horrors, the same as the musical. And it's the same story with the man eating plants and the nebbish forest.
I'm going to have to look. I have not seen that one. I've only seen
it's the original one from like the mid to late 50s and black and white.
Nice.
I'm
going to have to look this one up and get it so that we have them.
And it should be in public domain too. That's when Roger Corman was doing a lot of indie stuff, but before he sort of became Roger Corman, the company or New World Entertainment, that sort of thing.
Okay, cool. Well, thank you. And I will have Mr. Boss sit down and watch this because he hasn't, and you need to.
Does that become the one movie you get to pick every year then?
Well, you know, it's funny.
They also have a really great Funko Pop of Audrey too. So.
I've seen you, yeah. Be fun. Yeah, after the conversation we had the other day regarding TV shows and movies and everything that he was ranting on was that Wednesday? One of the comments that was made by me was because we've been watching Superman, the animated series, and okay. I had to break it to him. Well, I enjoyed the movies that, you know, we have and everything. Superman just doesn't interest me.
See, and, we've only gotten a few episodes into the animated series.
Okay,
so.
You also let me take home, meaning leaving your place and taking it all the way to the other side of town, you know, 22 miles away to my place to read the six comic books, and I only read one of them, and then give them back to you because... One, I didn't want to read the rest of them, and
these would be John Byrne's Man of Steel reboot after Crisis on Infinite Earth.
And
it is a character flaw in Mrs. Boss that I have yet to correct.
And after I said this, and he walked down the hallway to head back to the back to take care of some business, the kid sits there and looks at me and says, I'm surprised he hasn't asked for a divorce yet.
We weren't married yet.
Well, no. Now that I've said this to you.
Oh, yeah, well.
I'd like to let you know that we've been married now for over 4.5 years.
Has it been that long, really?
The kid's birthday is our half anniversary.
Yes, I know.
Okay.
Road Vagabond Life says, how can she be a fan of Little Shop of Horrors and not like Hanna-Barbera shows? Well, this Superman...
I'm not saying I don't...
Hang on. Let me clear something up. This is the Superman animated series from the 90s. This is not a Hanna-Barbera thing. This is the Bruce Timm era. Paul Dini, Bruce Timm, that set. So just to clarify this up. This is the one with Daly as Superman.
And apparently Mr. Clockface.
The Clock King.
Oh, wait.
No, that
mind.
Was
That's
that was
Batman,
Batman and Brave and the Bold.
Yeah. Never mind. I was looking at that cuz I was talking to someone at work.
See, this is why we don't run so many we don't binge too many episodes different
Dee,
shows at
Dee
once
Bradley
because
Baker is like the Jeffrey Combs of voice acting.
Yeah, I know, but I don't think Dee Bradley Baker is in.
You've got the
Brave and the Bold.
Traditional.
Yes, he is. He plays
the fake.
He plays
Batman, Brave and the Bold.
He plays Clockface.
You know, Clockface costume. Then you have the efficiency expert, Clock King, in Bruce Timm's. Dark Knight, Batman in the animated series. There you go.
Yeah, there's different iterations of that character.
Well, anyway.
Yeah.
I was looking it up to make sure I had the right name because he didn't know what I was talking about right away. And I sat there, and when I was looking, it said Dee Bradley Baker and Clockface. I'm like, oh, he's in everything.
Well, Jeffrey Combs shows up in the Justice League animated show, too.
Well, Jeffrey Combs is in everything, too.
But you can't get to the Justice League show without watching the Superman show. I mean, it's a different guy playing Superman. Tim Daly doesn't play Superman in Justice League. George Newbern does. But it's still the same. It's in the same universe.
Okay. See, I don't. Okay. I don't know what it is. Uh-huh. He doesn't. Is he too much of a
Superman
Boy Scout?
Superman has always had this reputation of being like a big bit of a Boy Scout.
Yeah,
At least to people that weren't like sort of diehard fans of Superman. That quibble has been actually addressed in like numerous different comic books about like, is he too good? You know, specifically most recently in Superman versus Elite.
Because
there's a team of superheroes that kind of work in a gray area and objecting to like, you know, killing villains or something like that, or using force to take them out.
See,
like
this is
force
this is the problem that I have with single issues having such a huge impact, because Superman versus the Elite is one issue in the run, and it's the same kind of thing like the Killing Joke. Killing Joke was one issue, and it changed everything, and it wasn't even supposed to be part of the continuity, the mainline continuity. You get these things that, you know, the in The Flash, you had one episode, you had one issue with the Rainbow Raider, for example. You have these little one-offs that turn into this thing, and suddenly there's all of this debate and all of this back and forth and everything about us. There was an issue of Superman. I want to say it was either Action. I think it was Action Comics. It might have been Superman. This is back in the late 70s, early 80s. And it's one issue, and it basically established, and then they ignored it, established that the lenses in Clark Kent's glasses are made of Kryptonian glass from his rocket ship. And they create the effect of hypnotizing everybody around him to make everybody think that he looks more frail than he actually is. Oh, that... It's an intriguing notion, but that's one issue. And then they completely ignored it after that. And it's never been in the comics again that I know of. And yet it still is this thing. That's
they're
out
waiting.
There.
They're like, waiting for lens crafters to come in and, you know, fund it.
One issue. This thing happens all the time.
Kind of Silver Age goofiness that they were doing.
It wasn't goofy. It was a good thing because basically the way they talked about it was when he first got his heat vision. You know, it would destroy regular glasses because, you know, terrestrial materials and whatnot, his heat vision kept melting his glasses. And so he crafted lenses from the rocket ship glass, which could withstand if he had, you know, if his heat vision went off. And the hypnotic effect thing was just, it was a MacGuffin for the story. But, I don't know. Michael says, Mrs. Boss, if you only get to choose one movie per year, there are far worse. Yeah, there are. Last Jedi was far worse.
Well, I mean, Mr. Boss goes through because I need to be edumacated. Okay, well, so does he. Not really. there are movies within his genre love here that he has not seen that I have, and it's like Starman. We've had that sitting on the TV stand for over a year.
Well,
I think
it's been a while. Yeah,
it. We only saw it after we went to Meteor Crater, which I had to sit there and because as we were sitting and driving down from Grand Canyon, it's like, oh, that's here. Yeah, that's not so far away, and I've already been there before. Mm. And so on the way back, when we were heading home from L.A. and, you know, going from L.A. up and then to Gallup, New Mexico, we stopped there. Yeah. And so finally, he was able to have that Leonardo DiCaprio meme moment. Ooh, ooh, ooh! He gets that reference.
Okay.
Yes, you did that.
I did not ooh, ooh, ooh like a monkey. I mean, come on. Don't give me that look.
I just did. Mm-hmm. Anyway, right. So he was able to.
What about Horshack?
Horshack, yeah. I mean, Horshack did it better. But I didn't sound like Horshack either. And Mrs. Boss probably doesn't even know who Horshack is.
No, this is your Cocker Spaniel look.
See, there's much to add to that list.
Well, okay. But see, the thing is that on occasion, I would like to sit there and pick something for you to, you know, have to deal with sitting through. You know, the fact that, what's the guy who did Rogue One? Oh, I can't think of his name.
Gilroy?
Yeah,
Tony Gilroy?
He did The Cutting Edge. Maybe I want to sit and make you go through that, regardless of how much you really have no interest in hockey.
It's a sports movie. It's a
figured. It doesn't matter. I could sit there and say that to you.
Yeah, Debbie Sweeney and what's her name? Well, who?
Moira Kelly.
Moira Kelly, yeah.
Moira Kelly, yeah, as the hockey player
it's a good movie.
Road Vagabond Life says Little Shop of Horrors is worth it just for Steve Martin's performance as a crazed, sadistic dentist.
Yes. And the fact that they sit there and they have a shot of them singing in the mouth, where they're looking out of his mouth
mm-hmm.
while they're singing.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's
okay.
It's freaking hilarious. But anyway. And it's Rick Moranis. I may have had a minor crush on him growing up.
I guess there are worse choices you could make.
Have you looked in the mirror lately?
I don't look like Rick Moranis.
No, but there's worse choices. Yes. You be nice to me.
Now, we were talking about how Superman is kind of like a sort of a Boy Scout.
Yeah.
Or you know, sometimes perceived as a Boy Scout.
Yes.
There was another character that is sort of like that, but he always kind of, in the comics, especially in the earlier ones, he was treated in more of like a campy manner. In fact, some of his villains would call him the Big Red Cheese. And of course, that's like Shazam.
No, it's Captain Marvel. He's Captain Marvel.
Yeah, Captain Marvel or Shazam, the original Captain Marvel. I bring this up to say that they are doing a major kind of character overhaul with him right now, currently at DC.
Another one?
It's coming off of this event called Lazarus Planet, which dealt with the sort of like a magic war within the DC universe. And it seems that Billy Batson has chosen to amp up a little bit more of his wisdom of Solomon. If you know of Shazam, he has all of these aspects of different gods and stuff like that. And apparently in this iteration of Shazam, he is actually pulling powers from the gods. So he's like borrowing them temporarily and stuff. And with the wisdom of Solomon, he is now kind of turning into sort of two distinct personalities. Whereas Billy Batson, the young boy, teenager, had the ability to, you know, call upon Shazam, you know, and turn into Captain Marvel whenever he said the word Shazam. Now Shazam, because of this amped up wisdom of Solomon, is able to turn on his appearances at will. And the young boy, teenager Billy Batson, doesn't necessarily have control over Shazam anymore. And so it's sort of like becoming a very, I don't want to say Jekyll and Hyde, but it's a very sort of a split dynamic where it's actually two entities, sort of like Jason Blood and Ichabod the Demon.
Yeah.
They're approaching it that way now.
Well, the thing that has always struck me about Captain Marvel and Billy Batson, and this is pre-New 52, because New 52, whatever you may think about Geoff Johns, how good of a writer he is, how much of a hack he is, whatever, Geoff Johns did a very bad, he made a very bad choice with Captain Marvel coming out of New 52. Because if you stop and think, okay, well, Billy Batson is a kid, 13, 14 years old, 12 years old, however old he is. When he invokes Shazam and the magic and he turns into Captain Marvel and he has all of these powers, the wisdom of Solomon being one of them, and all of this other stuff, that changes his personality. That changes who he is fundamentally. And Captain Marvel is an adult. It's not big, with a cape. And I know that's how they did it with Zachary Levi's Captain Marvel. Captain Marvel has the wisdom of Solomon. He is a mature, grown-up, adult man, not Billy Batson in a grown-up costume. And I think Geoff Johns made a very poor choice in making Captain Marvel with Billy Batson's personality. I think it's a dumb thing to do because you have the wisdom of Solomon's the first one in the acronym Shazam Solomon, and a 12-year-old with the wisdom of Solomon is not going to act like a 12-year-old. I've always had a problem with this iteration of Captain Marvel.
I really enjoyed the storytelling for Captain Marvel when he, of course, when he turned in to Captain Marvel and said the word Shazam. Okay, he was the adult, he was the superhero, he was super powerful, but he was still subject to some kind of like aw shucks moments, you know, more of like a sort of innocent abroad.
Yeah.
As in that, and I enjoyed that. I haven't really encountered a narrative that played into like the wisdom of Solomon or that sort of thing. And I think that goes all the way back to like the Fawcett interpretations of Shazam, where they were, you know, fun kind of punch 'em ups and, you know, like, oh, you big red cheese.
Right.
You know, with the, like, evil villains and stuff like that. And it's just interesting to see, and a little bit disheartening on my end to see that they're having this sort of like split, you know, personality narrative that they're going for currently, where Shazam, Captain Marvel, the adult superhero, is totally trying to separate himself from the child,
yeah,
Billy Batson, which, if in the origin story, you know that the wizard Shazam chose Billy Batson because of his heart and, you know, to a degree his innocence, so to carry on that power. And so that became kind of an integral part to Captain Marvel's, you know, sort of power set, because
right.
He,
but
the wisdom is not Solomon. He wasn't naive or anything like that. But he did have those, like I said before, kind of all shucks moments, and
right?
Stuff like that,
but
you know?
But still, with the power set, there's still two distinct personalities there. I mean, if you go back, you look at the CBS, the Filmation live action stuff on CBS Saturday morning. Same kind of thing. You have Billy Batson, you have Captain Marvel, and it's almost like they're two completely different people. And that's an interpretation from the TV show, I know, but sometimes that kind of separation between the two personalities, I think, works better. But yeah, you're right in the whole aw shucks stuff. You know, I'm perfectly fine with Captain Marvel being that a little bit that way. It's almost like he's a little more corn-fed than Superman is. You know, they both have the same kind of values almost. Yeah, so I'm fine with that. But I don't like, it's me, Billy. No, it's not. You're Captain Marvel now. You're not Billy now. They're completely different entities almost. So I'm and yeah, Cam says it wouldn't say different people, but a different maturity and different development level. That's the thing that I'm talking about, is the way his personality is affected by the power set changes him into a different person almost. Not literally, but just from a standpoint of personality dynamic and how he interacts with people and how he even sees the world, the power set changes all of that. So I don't know.
Exactly. And it looks like this new series of stories is dividing him into two distinct entities that don't necessarily cross over. In fact, are fighting for control of Batson's personality and will, that sort of thing.
Interesting.
So it's like a possession story almost.
Now, who's writing that? Is that still was it Josie Campbell? Is that who's writing this stuff now?
Because
she wrote Lazarus Planet, We Were Once Gods, number one. Or is it Mark Waid? Because I'm seeing a couple of different things here.
Let's see.
Oh, that's January 23. This one is... Well, this is January 23 as well, so maybe this is a while back. I guess maybe Mark Waid's writing it?
I believe so. Let me double check.
Is Mark Waid writing Shazam?
This just came across my newsfeed a couple of days ago.
Yeah, because Lazarus Planet was a year ago.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting. Okay. Well, maybe Josie Campbell did the miniseries and Waid picked up the ongoing. Yeah. By the way, like we were talking about earlier with Paul, the box office for Civil War, $2.9 million in previews, best ever for an A24 movie, according to Variety. So there is that. I don't know. I don't know if I want to see this or not. I probably should. Probably should see it. But,
Yeah, it's Mark Waid currently, and he's trying to... take him back to quote unquote his roots. And trying to reverse what New 52 did to the character,
which is good. And I hate to even, you know, agree with Mark Waid because he's such a terrible person, but that's good that he's trying to do that. So anyway, all right, what time is it? We've gone an hour. Nobody else is calling in? Okay, that's fine. I see how it is. Be that way. That's fine. No curmudgeon council today. All right, so... I see. All right, so now Snob dials in. How are you, sir?
Good, I was waiting for you to beg.
Waiting for me to beg? Right. Okay, what's up?
Oh, not much.
Okay.
So next week,
yes,
we have our topic set up. First Monday topic is who's the most beautiful woman in the world and why is it Sydney Sweeney? And all topics will be that for the rest of the week.
Okay. All right.
In honor of Pam.
All right. Make sure you have really good thumbnails.
Oh, yeah.
You know, Sydney Sweeney thumbnails, right?
I've been doing a lot of research in that area.
Are we taking bets on how much our subscriber count goes up?
Well, it's not going to be on our channel. It's going to be on Snob's channel.
Oh, zero. That's my bet. Oh, maybe. Maybe you'll go up.
You might get some subscribers off of that, maybe.
I might.
I mean, that's kind of the point, right? Is to get people to subscribe to your channel so you feel a little bit more obligated to do some more videos on a regular basis.
Yeah, that's the point.
Yeah.
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 It was actually just find some worth in my life.
I find value in your time and attention there. Snob.
That's right. That's Cam, I'm trying to find it for myself.
Cam says y'all will funnel right back to this channel. So okay, I expect some cross promotion. That's what I told him, but did you lie?
Crickets.
No.
That's okay. We can lose subscribers just fine on our own. I guess that's what we do.
We don't need help on that.
The plan is to steal them.
Yeah. We picked up another. We're back to 2512. So you've got 2512 that you can steal. So
enjoy it while it lasts.
Yeah.
I'll be gone by this time next Friday.
I'm being reminded that our subscriber count does go up the more often we're absent. So that that could be. We could do that. We gone for a week and our number goes up by 500, right?
The less you post, the more subscribers you get.
That's right. We'll have to test that strategy, I guess. So, anyway.
You're still getting big echo here.
Is it? Yeah, we got to switch back to Zoom. I don't know what's going on with StreamYard. It's got to be in StreamYard, so.
Well, Cam and I were testing it yesterday, and he came in as a guest.
Yeah.
Didn't have any echo, he said.
That's weird, because you guys are all in as guests as well on this one.
So I hosted, and he came in.
Yeah.
No echo on his side as a guest.
That's weird, because I don't know what would be causing it. Because the audio comes in.
Are you running it through something?
Well, I'm running it through. I'm doing it the same way as I always have, and I didn't used to get an echo.
So how are you doing it?
Well, audio is coming out from the tower, from the headphone jack. And it's going to my soundboard, my sound mixer, so I can mix it in with the microphones that we got here in the studio. And then that's going back to the tower in the line in port. And none of that has changed. This is the same setup that we had when we were in the other room and the studio before that. Nothing's changed on the path that everything goes on.
So you don't run it through OBS or anything like that?
Well, OBS is sending it out to is sending it out to the streams, but the audio, well, I don't know, because the audio to StreamYard is the line in. And then the microphone port here on OBS is pulling all of that in from the thing. That shouldn't be doing anything. We shouldn't be getting an echo. I don't know. We got to switch back to Zoom anyway because there's other things. Other things that we got to switch to. Road Vagabond Life said Paul sounded fine, but he had on headphones. I don't know if that's making a difference or not, because Snob, you're on a headset, right?
I am.
And you're still getting an echo.
Yes.
That's weird. That's weird. Because that's a recent development. I don't know why it's doing that. Except that
it's... Like I said,
you're
not an echo. It's just...
I'm not echoing. There's no echo guests. For me?
Yeah, it's just myself and the other guests.
Okay, so you're here. You're hearing yourself.
There's no echo from you, Jason. It's just the other guests that come on.
That's weird. That's very weird, because... Okay, I'm gonna do something here. Okay, for everybody who is in the stream, I'm going to do something. I'm going to turn the audio off going out to the stream for a second through OBS. This is just a test. I want to see if there's an echo after I turn this off. So everybody sit tight for just a second. I'm going to do this now. Okay, so that's not the problem. That's weird. I'm gonna have to go through and see if I can diagnose a little bit of that. So, in the meantime, well, I got a week to figure it out because we won't be on all week next week. So, Sci-Fi Snobs channel for Dead from the Dugout And we'll see what happens there. Same time, 1 p.m. Eastern. And I don't expect you guys to go for 3 hours or anything. So, I mean, you can. It's your show.
We're going to do everything we do. We're going to do it times 100.
Times 100? Okay. All right. Sounds good. All right.
It'll be bigger and better than ever.
Well, it'll be bigger and better than anything you've done.
That's true.
Yeah.
My first lives.
You're going to set yourself a new standard, right?
Yes.
Yeah. All right. Okay. That's going to do it for us today, folks. I'm going to go ahead and call it because I got to go run a couple of errands outside the compound. I'm not looking forward to that. So you can find us on all the different socials, different video platforms and whatnot. Subscribestar is active if you want to support us financially. There's a newsletter. There's Discord. Of course, email address, livefromthebunker@scififorme.com. I guess I should put that on this list here. That's it. And we hope you have a great weekend. Christopher, Snob, both of you, thanks very much for being here. I want to thank Paul Dergarabedian for jumping in and giving me some time. It's always good to hear from him. So we're looking forward to the next time he's on. And again, dark next week. Back on the 22nd. In the meantime, go check out Sci-Fi Snob's channel. Go subscribe to him. And we'll do this again. Have a great weekend, folks. Remember, the politicians hate you. The media lies to you. But God has a plan for you. And there are 4 lights.
This has been a presentation of Sci-Fi for Me TV. Copyright 2024 by Flaming Dog Media, LLC. All rights reserved. No portion of this program may be retransmitted without the express written consent of Flaming Dog Media. You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV.